What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel.
In the previous videos of this series, we tackled various implementations of the binary tree, such as binary search trees, AVL trees, and red-black trees. Therefore, in today's video, we are going to explain and implement an additional application of binary trees known as a heap. Heaps are essentially tree-based data structures, binary trees to be more precise. So, if you are not familiar with binary trees, or at least the basic tree terminology, I suggest you take a look at the tree's introductory video available here on Geekific. With that said, let's proceed with our main topic. So, these trees, or heaps, are always complete. And usually, when we refer to a heap, we have to specify if it's a maximum or a minimum heap. Because you see, there are two types of heaps. In a maximum heap, for example, the value stored inside any node is always bigger than the values stored inside its children nodes or subtrees, as you can see here in this example. This means that the highest value stored will always be in the root. We also don't care, as we did in binary search trees, whether the left child is smaller than the right child. All we care about is that their parent is bigger than both of them. Whereas in a minimum heap, the value inside any node is smaller than the values of its children, always, making the root node the smallest element in the whole tree. Now the question you may be asking is, why do we need such a tree? Can't we do whatever we need to do using the binary search tree we previously saw? Well, having the maximum or minimum element always located at the root makes its retrieval very fast, as the root node is the first element you have access to in a tree. Contrary to binary search trees where we had to go to the far right or far left side of the tree to retrieve the maximum or minimum item respectively. Now, take this maximum heap storing customer objects for example. The biggest customer can be calculated using one or many of its fields, meaning that a maximum or minimum can be obtained by means different than the mathematical or lexicographic maximum or minimum. And consequently, if you take this idea and implement it using heaps, you will obtain a very efficient and powerful implementation of the abstract data type we call priority queues. In a priority queue, we have to dequeue the values stored in it based on a certain attribute, the priority. And this priority is exactly the same thing we just calculated using one or many of the customer class fields. So, if the priority queue was implemented with the help of maximum heaps, for example, the element with the highest priority will be stored at the root, and the time required to access it or dequeue it will be optimal in the order of O of 1. Okay, we just mentioned that heaps are binary trees, and are an implementation for the priority queue. However, even though heaps are represented as binary trees, they are mainly implemented using arrays, not using nodes like binary search trees, for example. So how do we do that? Well, because a heap is complete, we can, while traversing the heap tree on a line-by-line basis, assign each node to an array slot sequentially, as you can see in front of you. So, the root node will sit at index 0, and the last node at the bottom level of the tree will be located at the last index of the array. But now that we have an array, how will we be able to look up a specific node, or its parent value, or its child? Any given node and its children will be connected using these equations. Let's try them on a specific value or index. Let's say node 18. It has an index 2. Using this equation, its left child should have an index of 5, and its right child should have an index of 6. And if we go back to our array representation of that heap, we can see that this is indeed true. Additionally, if we take node 8 with its index 6, we subtract 1 from it and divide it by 2, we will obtain 2, which is the index of 18, the parent of 8. Now let's switch to the operations offered by heaps, as these operations are what we will be actually implementing. The operations offered by a heap are all specific to the root node. So we may retrieve the root node or the node with the highest value if we are in a maximum heap, or the node with the smallest value in case of a minimum heap. And while inserting an element, what we do is just insert the value as if we are inserting at the end of our heap array. However, after the insertion, we have to adjust our tree by moving our nodes around in order to make sure that the maximum value is still located at the root node. This adjustment is done by moving from bottom to top in the tree, starting at the node we just inserted until we reach the root. The node we inserted is compared to its current parent, and if the parent has a bigger value than this node, we swap them. This process is then repeated until we reach the root. The second operation we have access to is removing and returning the root. And of course, after removing it, we have to place the new highest or smallest value to be the new root of the maximum or minimum heap respectively. Additionally, and contrary to the insert operation, retrieving the new root of our tree after the delete operation is done by traversing the heap from top to bottom. So we start at the root or index 0 in the heap array and keep traversing the tree until we reach the last index of the heap array or the end node. But if the root is removed, how are we going to be able to start at the root? Well, before traversing the tree from top to bottom, the first step is to place the last element in the array at the root location and then traverse the tree from top to bottom to find the new root. Now, let's try to implement these operations for both the maximum and minimum heaps. The first thing I did was create the interface of our heap class. In this interface, you can see the insert method, which will insert an item to the heap, the getRoot method, which will remove the root node from the heap and return it, and finally, the sort method, which will sort our heap array using the HeapSort algorithm. We will expand on this algorithm further in a few, but for now, let's try to implement the insert and getRoot methods. To do this, I created the heap class and made it abstract, as we will later on extend this class by two different classes, the maximum heap class and the minimum heap class. You see, we can go ahead and create two separate classes, one for the maximum and another for the minimum heap. However, both of these implementations share a lot in common, and therefore the best approach is to abstract them into one class, the heap class. In addition to this, and similarly to the interface, I made this class generic to be able to store any kind of objects inside our heaps. Concerning the fields of this class, it will, of course, have a generic array, which is our heap array. And I also added an integer called position. This position attribute will help us keep track of the last element inside our heap. So if the total capacity of our array is 100, let's say, but currently inside it we only have 20 items, then the position attribute will be equal to 19, as indices start at 0. The last thing I want to show you before we actually start with the insert method is the constructor of this class. It is a pretty straightforward one, as we simply need to initialize our generic array. We are setting its initial capacity to 2 only, as we are going to make it a resizable array. Now, on to the insert method. I started my implementation by checking if our heap is full or not, because if it is full, we will have to resize our array as I just mentioned. The heap is considered full when the position integer is pointing to the last element in our heap array or the element stored at heap.length-1. To resize our array, we have to pass to the resize method the new capacity of our heap. In this case, we chose to double its capacity. The resizing is done using the system.arrayCopy method. If you have watched our stack array or queue array implementation videos, you may be already familiar with the use of this method. Now, if the heap array isn't full, or if we did the resizing, what we do to insert the item to the heap is increment the position index, as it was initialized to -1. Then, assign the data pass to the method by the user to this position located in the heap array. After doing that, and as I previously mentioned, we need to traverse our heap from bottom to top in order to make sure that the maximum or minimum element is still located at the root. To do this, we call the fixUpward method. This method will be an abstract method, as its implementation differs from a maximum to a minimum heap. After calling this method, I chose to return the whole tree to be able to chain insertion calls. However, this is a personal choice, and you can return whatever you see fit. Now, let's try to implement the fixUpward method and start with its maximum heap implementation. We previously mentioned that this method should start at the element we just inserted, hence the item located at the position index, and should keep comparing its value to its parent until it reaches its correct spot. Additionally, we also mentioned that a parent and a child node are connected to each other by the formulas you can see in front of you. So, we can start our implementation by retrieving the index of the element we just inserted and the index of its parent. Then, while the value of the child is bigger than the value of the parent, and while we haven't yet reached the top of our heap or the zero index, then we need to swap the node in question with its corresponding parent. The swapping logic is pretty straightforward and was covered multiple times in various previous videos, so I'll just drop it here for you to see. Additionally, I recommend to place this logic in the abstract heap class and not in the maximum heap class, as it can be reused by the minimum heap implementation. Finally, after the swapping is performed, what we need to do is hop one node forward, in this case upwards, to be able to continue our iteration and heap traversal. To do this, we have to assign the index variable to be equal to the parent index and recalculate the new parent index using the same formula we used before. Now, concerning the minimum heap fix upward method implementation, it is actually very similar to this one. The one difference you have is the greater sign. If you replace the greater than sign in the while loop condition with a smaller than sign, you will obtain the complete insert method implementation for the minimum heap as well. Let's move on to the getRoot or remove method. In this operation, I started by checking if our heap is empty or not in order to avoid null pointer exceptions. And if that is the case, then I am returning the null value. If it isn't, we have to proceed by storing the value of the root in a temporary result variable in order to return it later. After doing that, we take the last element of our array, or the element stored at the position index, and place it at the root, just like we previously mentioned, all while decrementing the position attribute to simulate the deletion of this element. We now have two similar items stored inside our array, the first and the last one. To fix this, we go ahead and assign a null to the last index to remove this last redundant one. Finally, and before returning with the removed root element, we have to fix our tree, but downwards, by starting at the root and going all the way down to the position index. The fix downward method, similarly to the fix upward one, is an abstract method in the heap class, as it has different implementations for the maximum and minimum heaps. So, let's go ahead and try to implement it for the maximum heap. Okay, so we can start with this if statement, and what this does is it checks if the tree had only one item stored inside it. Think about it, if the tree had only one single element, and we just removed it and decremented the position index, then this position would now be equal to -1, and consequently, no fixing is required, simply because the tree is empty. However, if the tree isn't empty, then we have to initialize an index variable to 0. And while this index is smaller than the end index provided, in this case equal to the position index, then we have to compare our node to its children and swap them accordingly to fix our heap array. Now, because we are starting at the root, we can't retrieve the parent as we did for the fix upward method. So what we have to do is retrieve the children nodes. The left and right children are connected to their parent by the equations you see in front of you, which we discussed several times across the video. In addition to this, and because the index of the right child is always bigger than the index of the left child, we have to check if the index of the left child is bigger than the end index provided to the method. If that is the case, then we have to break out of the while loop, as we already exceeded the bounds defined to us by the end index, and no swapping can be performed. Now it is time to retrieve which child should be swapped with the parent, or if one should be in the first place, with the node we have. So if the right child is bigger than the end index provided, then this child cannot be picked and we have to pick the left child. However, if both of them are smaller than the end index provided, then we have to pick the child having the biggest value. This is done using the compareTo method. After picking our child, we have to check if this child is bigger than the parent or not, because if it isn't, then our tree is already a valid heap and we can end our traversal, hence exit our while loop. But if it's bigger than its parent, then we have to swap the parent node or the element located at the index variable with the child to swap we picked. And finally, to keep iterating and continue our traversal, we have to hop one node downwards. This is done by assigning the index variable to the chosen child index value. Now, concerning the minimum heap fix downward method implementation, it is also actually very similar to this one, same as the fix upward. And to adapt this method to work for a minimum heap, you have to replace both greater than signs in the ternary expression and in the if statement with a smaller than sign. With this modification, you will obtain the complete delete method implementation for the minimum heap as well. Now that we can insert elements into our heap and retrieve the root element, what remains is sorting the elements of the heap using the HeapSort algorithm. And before actually implementing the sort method, let's try to understand how this algorithm works. We already established that the maximum element is at the root. So how we do this is that we first take this element, the maximum or minimum, and swap it with the element located at the very end of our array. In our example, this will result in the tree you see to your right-hand side. Then, we consider our tree to be the whole array minus this element. So, consequently, we have to find the new maximum in our new tree by traversing this tree from top to bottom. And when we find it, we have to place it at the root, which is its normal place to be, given our new tree. Next, the new root is swapped with the element at the new end, and then we proceed by finding its successor to the root position. Which means that the same process is repeated until all the array is sorted and no root nodes are left to be found. Now, let's go ahead and implement the sort method in the abstract heap class. The first step in the heap sort algorithm is to swap the root node with the last element of our tree or heap array. To do this, in code, we can make use of the swap method we previously implemented. This method will swap the root located at position 0 with the last item located at the position index. The next thing we did was place the new biggest or smallest node at the root. And to do this, we can make use of the fix downward method we just implemented. However, the end index we have to provide it with is the position minus 1 index, as what we need to do is find the new maximum or minimum without taking into consideration the last element of the heap array we just swapped. Now, these two lines of code we wrote are perfectly fine. However, we mentioned that this process should be repeated until there are no nodes left inside the heap array. This is done by wrapping what we wrote with a for loop, initialized at index 0 and going all the way to the position index. But if we leave the swap and the fix downward methods as is, we will be swapping and traversing our array all the way till the end while repeating ourselves. So what we do is subtract the index we are currently at, or the number of elements we already sorted from the end index provided to the fix downward method, and from the element we want to swap with the root item. And that's it. When you run this method, your heap array should become sorted. What you can also do is add at the end a printing logic to print out to the console the sorted array. If you go with the same implementation I did, the maximum heap will print out the elements sorted in ascending order, whereas the minimum heap will print them out in descending order. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I'll see you in the next one.